Hello, hi everybody. So today we're going to do a so-called a webinar talking about best practice post-COVID-19. This is a preparation for our Insta Live this Tuesday, where Professor Worapong and I will be discussing about what we should do after this COVID-19 crisis, what is the best practice, and we kind of want to have a lot of involvement of all Asian doctors to come out with the best practice to protect ourselves, our staff, as well as our clients or patients who come to our practice. So without further ado, I think Professor Worapong needs no introduction. He's very famous. He's a professor of dermatology in the Syria Hospital, Mahidol University. And I think he has done a lot of great work. And this time he has dwelled into what are the evidence about the best practice for the contagion, and what are the recommendations from him. So, Professor Worapong, please.
Hi. Hello, everybody. Thanks for coming to join this meeting. So, we have been locked down in Thailand for almost 3 weeks. So, I have a lot of time working at home. And during my work at home, I do spend a lot of time doing research and getting some recommendation from colleagues of how to resume the practice safely. So today I'm going to share with you some of the evidence that we've been getting and some of the recommendation that we come out with. Oh, and how do I move? Okay, this is the acknowledgement. The information that I'm going to share with you is not only the thing that came from me. We spent a lot of time doing some research from the PubMed, from the CDC and WHO guidelines. And we draft up some recommendation about how to do practice measures when we are going to resume our practice. And this kind of information, there are 5 or 6 people totally that helped to come out with this information. I have my 2 clinical fellow, which is Kate and Nice, who are helping me to did some research. And after we draft up this kind of evidence, we also send it to our professor in the Division of Infectious and Tropical Disease Department of Medicine at Sri Lanka Hospital to read it. And we also get recommendation from a professor of virus at the Microbiology Department at Sri Lanka Hospital. So this, and we also get recommendation from Dr. Mitch Goldman, which is the ex-president of the American Society of Dermatologic Surgery. So this is the acknowledgement. So what I would like to share with you are these 3 things. So we heard and we encounter a lot with the COVID-19, but there are some facts that we must know in order to prevent ourselves or to do a safer practice. And we came out with some preventive measures in dermatology or in aesthetic practice, and we are going to share with you with this preventive measure. And we have come out with some recommendations of how to do a very safe practice afterward. So before I'm going to start sharing the information, I must tell you that this is not the thing that I know the best. There are many things that are unknown. And another problem is nobody knows that when will this COVID-19 will be under control. But we, as a human or as a doctor, we must learn how to survive. So this is the fact of COVID-19. This is a disease that comes from a virus that name SARS-CoV-2. And when you infected with this kind of virus, you can get a really broad range of mild to severe acute respiratory syndrome. And COVID-19 was announced by WHO on March the 11th to be a pandemic. The way of transmission of this COVID-19 are two ways, but the primary or the major transmission route is the inhalation of the droplets that contain the SARS-CoV-2. But you can also get self-inoculated to indirectly contact when you have the germ and contact to the oral, nasal, or ocular mucosa. So if you look into the spectrum of clinical manifestation of COVID-19, luckily that 81% of the infected patients come with very mild symptoms. But there are 14% who got severe symptoms, like have some dyspnea, hypoxia, or have the lung involvement over 50% from the image. And out of this, there are 5% of infected patients who will need to be admitted into the critical care. And out of this 5% of patients who admitted to critical care, 2% of them will be dead. So, but luckily that all of the dead cases are the cases that turned out when they were admitted in ICU. That means if you start with the mild case, you are not going to drop off or dead when you're sitting in the room. The bad thing is, so far we still don't have any good treatment for COVID-19. Most of the treatment are supportive or palliative. There are so many trials that have been going on since the outbreak. But as of today, we still don't have any effective treatment. There are many trials that use some of the HIV or malaria medication or some experimental antiviral compound, or even using the antibody-rich plasma from the COVID-19 patients. But none of them has been proved yet. And the only thing that may make us feel safe if the vaccination, that so far they are still working on the vaccination. So until we find the effective and the safe vaccination, you will need to control and have to protect yourself very well. So what are the risks that involve with COVID-19? The scary thing is 86.2% of the patients are infected from the undocumented case, and asymptomatic infected individuals are infectious. That means people who walking normally on the street may be the infector who spread the disease to you. This is the scary thing. So if you take a look closer to our practice as a doctor or aesthetic doctor who are doing aesthetic practice, our risk is the way when we see the patient, we will need to stay very close and touching the patient. And in some posterior, we will need to spend at least half an hour or even almost an hour staying face to face with the patient. And sometimes we will need to stay this close with the patient if we would like to see something in detail. So what are the other risks for dermatologists or laser surgeons that involve in this COVID-19 era? We will know that human papillomavirus can be transmitted to laser prune. And this SARS-CoV-2 virus is viable at room temp, and it can be last somewhere between 2 hours to 9 days. depending on the surface and depending on the temperature and depending on the humidity. If the room have a lot of humidity, the virus can stay longer. And not only the virus that can be found in the droplet, there are some evidence that already been published that you can find the viral shedding in plasma or in serum, even in the pre-symptomatic patient. So we do have some procedure that we, our patient have some kind of breathing or have abrasion. And there are more and more increasing number of asymptomatic patients nowadays. If you look into the activities that are at risk, for us as an aesthetic doctor or dermatologist, we've been taught that at the first consultation visit, we must spend a lot of time. So this is a very risky visit. And we do have a lot of procedure, like ablative procedure or some procedure that produce the smoke, like some electric cautery, electric desiccation, and also cryosurgery also can produce a lot of smoke. We do have a lot of procedure, ablative laser procedure, laser hair removal, fused with laser or picosecond laser that can produce the smoke in the room. We do have a lot of procedure that are very time consuming. Like if you were to do filler injections in multiple areas. You have some non-invasive facial tightening like monopolar RF, focused ultrasound, or HIFU that you will need to spend a lot of time with the patient. And in many procedures, the patient will need to repeat and come back every 2 weeks or every month to get the procedure again. You have the fat lifting, the mold micrographic surgery, or some excisional surgery that we will need to spend a lot of time with the patient, or even the simple comedone extraction where patient have a lot of comedone that you will need to spend with the patient with a very bloody procedure. And lastly, have to do some procedure inside the oral mucosa. This is a very scary thing to all of the dentists. And we also sometimes have to do the procedure inside the oral cavity. This is a very dangerous area because the virus also can be found in the salivary gland. So according to the recommendation of the American Dental Association that just announced an interim guidance on April the 1st, whenever you are going to do the procedure inside the oral cavities, they recommend the patient to have the pre-procedural mouth rinse. Two of the solution that's been guided. Number one is 1.5% hydrogen peroxide. And number two is 0.2% povidone. So this is two of the recommendation of pre-procedural mouth rinse that recommended by the ADA. So get back to our dermatology or aesthetic practice. There are so many things that we have to be very careful in terms of preventive measures. Not only our staff who have to do the administrative measure, but we also have to do the administrative measure for the patients who come to visit us at the clinic. And we also need to do the measure for the engineering or the environmental of our clinic, just to be stay safe. The thing that I'm going to share with you, I don't want to scare you out, but this is the thing that is the most effective protection to our staff, to ourselves, or to our patient. As long as so far, as of today, there is no treatment for COVID-19. Nobody would like to get infected. And nobody would like to get infected and pass the infection to your father, your mother, your kid, or to your grandparents at home. And you don't want to get infected and you will need to close your practice again for 2 weeks for quarantine. So I mean, that's why we come out with a very, very, very much concern and very stickful of the measure that I'm going to share with you. So in terms of administrative measure for the patient, right now, I believe in many countries, you reschedule all of the non-urgent appointment. But again, we will need to survive. Whenever the COVID-19 is under control, we will need to resume to our practice. But again, you will need to be very careful and screening the patients that are going or coming to see you at your office. So this is some of the recommendation for canceling. So we recommend you to cancel the patients who have even rocket fever. This is the recommendation from CDC that rocket fever means the body temperature that above 37.3 Celsius, which is considered as rocket fever. Or any patient who have flu-like symptom, cough, cold, or shortness of breath. Or any patient who have the risk or exposed to any suspicious person who can transmit the COVID-19 to them. So this is the cancellation criteria. So this is the recommendation. If we were to see the patient when the COVID is under control, when the patient arrives at our clinic in the waiting area, we recommend you to put the poster or the sign of how to prevent the COVID-19 or what is the COVID-19 preventive measure for patient education, so that all of them who come to see you and sitting in the lobby or in the reception area know that you care about them and you care about their safety. So we recommend you to do the temperature check and recommend you to do the universal face mask. This is our recommendation, not the recommendation by CDC, but we do want to keep everybody safe. And we recommend you to have every patient doing their hand rub with alcohol-based hand rub, or clean their soap, or clean their hand with soap and water before entering to the clinic. And lastly, we must limit the number of non-patient visitors because the nature of the aesthetic patient, they will come in with some friends or relative. So we will need to limit as minimum number as possible of the non-patient visitor. So when the patient walk inside the clinic, we should spread the chair at least 3 to 6 feet apart or use some barrier to separate the patient in the waiting area. And in the waiting area, we normally have a lot of toys or reading material that can be one of the spreader. So we highly recommend you to remove all of the toys or reading the material frequently or regularly clean it with the disinfection. So after the patient leave the clinic, we also will need to clean everything, starting with the counter, the bed, and the seat. And there are some recommendations from the CDC. Recommend the EPA register disinfectant that you can go to the CDC website and look at the recommendation of the EPA Environmental Protection Agency for the disinfectant. So let's get a closer look to our wrist when we do a ablative procedure or procedure that have a lot of smoke. If you take a look in the smoke that produced in the procedure room, yes, 95% are vapor, but there are 5% that contain particulate matter. And out of this 5% of particulate matter are both infectious and non-infectious matter. So what about the administrative measure for the staff? So nowadays, I believe that all of our staff are not allowed to travel. But there are some instances that staff may travel outside of the country. Do you need to prohibit the traveling outside the country? Or if you have some staff who have recent travel history, they must be quarantined for at least 14 days. And we will need to do temperature check at least twice a day, not once a day, because they will have the fluctuation of body temperature. And we highly recommend you to divide your staff into at least two working groups. And these two working groups will not get to see each other because they will have to work in a different worksheet. In case one of the members in one group get infected, you can still running your clinic. Because once one of the members of one group get infected, the whole group will have to be 14 days quarantine. So that's why we highly recommend you, if you don't want to close down your clinic again, please divide the staff into two working groups. And every single staff have to wear the face mask all the time when they have to contact with the patient. And we recommend all of the staff to have frequent hand cleaning with alcohol-based hand rub or soap and water very regularly. So what about inside the operative room? This is the risk that we plan to do in our practice. Like I mentioned earlier, no one wants to get infected. But if you don't care about this, just listen and keep it in mind. So we highly recommend you to wrap your machine surface or your bed with a plastic wrap so that you can change the wrap when the new patient coming in. Because as I mentioned earlier, patient can be self-inoculation of the COVID-19 virus and get infected when they are going back to home. So right now, I am working with a group who are the producer of the plastic lab. We are trying to come out with one kind of plastic lab that is very easy to cover and very easy to take off and change the new thing. And inside the operative room, we also recommend you to wear the protection, the PPE at all the time. You will need to wear the glove. And not only learning how to wear the glove, you will need to learn how to properly discard the glove whenever to change the new patient. And we highly recommend you to wear a long gown to protect your skin and your clothing. And you will need to wear the protection of your hair as well, because your hair also can be contact with any virus inside the room. And whenever you are going to do the procedure that is smoky, there are two kinds of respirator that recommended by CDC. Number one is the N95, and number two is the so-called FFR2 that you will need to wear and protect your mouth and your nasal orifice. And not only wearing the protective mask, you also have to wear the protective goggles. But whenever you perform laser procedure, we were taught to wear a goggle anyways. But not only the goggle, we also will need to wear face shield in order to cover the whole face. And in the room, whenever you do the ablative procedure, you will need to use a very high standard smoke evacuator. And the smoke evacuator nozzle will need to be as close as 1 inch to the origin of the smoke in order to suck all of the smoke away from the room or from the environment. And lastly, the thing that I highlighted in red is not a recommendation by WHO or CDC, but it's a recommendation from our infectious disease expert that if possible, we will need to cover the mouth and the nose of the patient with face masks all the time. Because as I mentioned earlier, there are more and more symptomatic infected patients that we cannot know. And whenever we cover the mouth and the nose, we can temporarily open it if the patient has something to do underneath the mask. So this is the recommendation. So this is maybe my future uniform in the really near future if we still do not have any vaccination of COVID-19. This is how to protect ourselves safe during the COVID-19 year. So I think some of you still don't know how to wear and put off the N95 properly. You can go into your YouTube and take a look into this video clip that teach you how to put on the N95 properly and how to take off or discard it properly. And when you look at the videotape carefully, you will need to wash your hand both before putting the mask on and after you put the mask on.
Using both hands, roll the nose piece to shape of your nose by pushing downward and upward, while moving your fingertips down both sides of the nose piece. Perform a face check by placing both hands completely over the mask. Be careful not to disturb the position and exhale sharply. If air loops around your nose, adjust the nose piece at the slab and step 5. If air leaks at the mask edges, adjust the strap back along the sides of your head. Perform the fit check again if an adjustment is made.
So you need to make sure that you wear it properly.
This strap is mandatory for all users of N95 masks and must be performed every time upon wearing. Perform hand hygiene after putting on masks.
See, you have to wash your hand again. And then you will need to learn how to take it off.
Perform hand hygiene after removal of mask and after putting on the reduced mask.
So that was the way how to properly put on and take off the mask. So what about the post-operative measure? Not only learn how to put on the PPE, but you also will need to learn how to properly remove the PPE and clean or dispose it. And again, every single time when you put on all kind of protection and take it off, you will need to wash your hand or doing the hand hygiene even after you take the glove off. So this is really important, and this is one of the steps that we did not know and ignore it. And this is the way of how to rub the hand or how to clean the hand. So basically, you will need to clean both the palm side, all area of the finger, the fingertip, the dorsal side, and the nail very well. And you will need to clean it for at least a period of 20 seconds. So the period of 20 seconds is the period that you sing the happy birthday song twice. And after cleaning, you will need to dry your hand with a clean towel and need to know how to properly turn off the tap and throw away the towel. So this is something that you will need to teach your staff of how to do it properly. Okay. So next is how to control or to measure the environment. So as I mentioned earlier, we will need to cover the machine surface and the base and change the new one every single time when we see the new patient. And remember, patients themselves can also self-inoculate or can be a spreader inside the room because the SARS-CoV-2 can survive in the room temperature for a period of 2 hours to 9 days, depending on the temperature and depending on the humidity inside the room. And this is the risk of viral in activating agent that can kill the virus within 1 minute. Starting with 62 or 61% of ethanol, 0.5% of hydrogen peroxide, 0.1% of sodium hypochlorite, and UVC irradiation. When you talk about UVC irradiation, I believe in many countries, there are so many people who are very crazy about UVC and bought a lot of UVC back at home or their practice. But actually, if you take a look on the evidence, so far there is no evidence support that UVC can cure the SARS-CoV-2 virus. But what they use is they use the UVC irradiation for the period since 2003 to cure the original SARS outbreak. So there will be more and more UVC lysos that coming out in the market in Thailand, and I believe in China, in Korea, we have the UVC robot that they can offer a service that coming into your practice whenever you off your operating hour, and they will come out with a robot, and the robot will walk around your office to clean the environment, or you can even buy the smaller robot or the standalone UVC lamp that you can put in any room. And this kind of lamp can be controlled with a mobile phone or the remote control outside of how to, when to switch on and switch off. And you must be very careful and tell your staff, because UVC are very dangerous to human eye or skin contact. So you will need to inform your staff or your patients in advance. So last but not least, we are not the only one in the world who encounter with the problems of COVID-19. And we are not the only field of medicines that facing the problem with these unknowns. With the other field of medicines, they also have to do a very close face-to-face physical examination with the patient. And not only the patient and the doctors, there are many healthcare workers who also have an equal risk of getting the infection. And not only passing the infection, you can also get the infection from each other. So whenever the COVID-19 is under control, we must be very careful of how to restart our practice effectively and safely. And you will need to follow whatever recommendation from the WHO or from your local society guideline for the safe of yourself, of your staff, and of your patient. And think about the positive thing. Because of this COVID-19, it taught us of how to rethink, how to relearn, and how to reset our mind. And this is all that I like to share with you and open for your comment and discussion. Thank you very much.
Very well said, Wurpong. I think that is one thing that we all need to do from now on. And I think that one thing that I think all of us will be thinking about is how we would want to go on with our practice, a new normalcy with a lot of vigilance. That means we have to assume everybody is asymptomatic infectious contagion until proven otherwise.
Before universal precaution.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, are you proposing doing the N95 all the time or only in specific treatment only?
I think I would use either the N95 or the laser proof mask, because if you use a proper standard laser proof mask, it can also filter out the particle, which is less than 0.1 micron.
Right. The N95 is actually very, very hard. Once you apply it for too long, it's a lot of pressure to the face. I've wear it once, a few times, I just like, oh.
So what I would do is wearing the laser proof mask and together with the face shield. So this is
protection. I totally agree. I think face shield will be something that, because that's one thing to prevent. We have one question.
And also use the smoke evacuator if you have any smoking procedure.
Yeah, all the ablative lasers and semi-ablative. Right. Yeah. And we have a question from Christy asking, if we separate into two groups of staff, one of the staff get positive, is the premise need to be closed?
Yes.
So
if you separate into two groups and one member of one group get infected, the whole group you need to be quarantined for 14 days.
Exactly. And this the reason why we separate into two groups is that just in case one person of this particular group has is diagnosed positive, the whole groups go into quarantine. You still need to sterilize the premises. Yeah. And then you still maintain open. Not like if the whole group stays together, if one person gets it, the whole practice has to close down.
2 weeks.
2 weeks. that's bad. If a month we get just two person, after 2 weeks, it's just the whole month is down. Is that what you're doing in the Dr. Che at your practice? Do you divide into two groups?
Yes. I think the most important thing is education about how to avoid infection to our staff. Because in Korea, there are so many patients who are infected, but who are asymptomatic. That's very scary, you know.
Yeah, it is scary. And the scary part is we also know that some people who sort of recovered from COVID-19 and later on actually had a re-diagnose that having COVID-19 again. And this is the scary part, because even if we have the vaccine, we are not sure if it's 100% going to help us to cover from it. But at least if we have something to help us to prevent from getting into a very serious condition, that will be helpful. But at the moment, that's too many unknowns that we have to deal with.
Yes, right. Go ahead.
Yeah, we don't even know this is because of misdiagnosis or reactivation. So we cannot be sure that even if I am cured from COVID-19, I cannot be sure. So that's the problem. So I think that virus is got rid of from my body, but there's some possibility of still viruses remaining in my body. So it's very hard to be with my family, you know.
Exactly. I think this is a good point because there's a lot of calls out there in especially in United States and in the Western world saying that as we have to do more testing and only allow those who are tested positive to go to work. And this is the scary part because if you're tested positive, doesn't mean that your virus cannot be reactivated and you might be a contagious in certain ways, maybe, I don't know.
That's right.
What do you think, Professor Warapong?
I totally agree with you. I think for now, we don't know a lot of things and the COVID-19 still cannot be controlled. So we will need to protect ourselves and our staff and our patients very well from being infected. That's why we come out with a very, very legit
a universal precautions that we can cover.
Universal precaution.
Yeah, we just assume everybody has it. We always assume that we have it, our patients have it, our staff have it, and try not to have this spread going on within our practice, right?
Believe it or not, I sent my recommendation, my manuscript to one of the American journals,
right.
And there was one reviewer comment that my recommendation is too much to read it.
Right, we never know. Right,
I think they may be getting the Trump idea.
Anyways, we'll open for discussion this Tuesday at 7 p.m. Bangkok time and 8 p.m. in Malaysia. So we'll have more discussion then in Instagram. Go to Instagram, log on, join both of us, and we can have more discussion then. All right, I think today we'll end here. And then thank you, everybody, for attending this. And let's have more sessions where we can have lots more discussion among Asian doctors. Thank you.
Thank you. Good. Stay safe, everybody.
Thank you. Stay safe.
Stay safe.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.